time.
Good morning, brothers and sisters.
Good morning.
Welcome to our online service. As you know, because of the recent infections in our church last Sunday, we have actually moved our service totally online this Sunday. But next week, our in-person service will be resumed. Let us remember Reverend Victor, Sarah's, and Santosh, and of course, our dear Tony, who are all recovering from COVID-19. Please keep them in your prayers. Some announcements. The Methodist Prayer Convention is on the 20th to 22nd of May, so keep the dates free. You'll get more notices later on through the weeks. The home survey is supposed to end on the end of April, but those who have completed the forms and have not passed them up, you can pass it to me in church next Sunday or pass it to any of the committee members. Clothes and toys for the Myanmar refugees, you can still pack them and send them to any committee members, or you can bring them to church next Sunday because they are coming to collect them next Sunday. Next Sunday is a special service. We are celebrating our church 17th anniversary and Mother's Day together. We have invited the Myanmar students to sing for us. They will give us a choral presentation. So do come together to worship the Lord and thank Him for His faithfulness. So let us now quieten our hearts and go to God in praise and worship. Pauline will now lead us in the praise and worship.
Okay, good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Before we start, I want to share Psalm chapter 89, verse 1. I will sing of the loving kindness of the Lord forever. To all generations, I will make known thy faithfulness with my mouth. Let's sing this song together. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercy of the Lord with my mouth, when I be known thy faithfulness with my mouth, when I be known thy faithfulness to all generations. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercy of the Lord. I will know when I be known thy faithfulness in my mouth, when I be known, the generation. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. Let's sing this song together. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. His cornerstone, his solid ground, found to the fairest rock and stone. But I shall love for death of peace, when Jesus filled the stirring seas. My comforter,
my all in all. You're in the love of Christ I stand. There in the ground His bonny lay. Light of the world my dawn has slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave He rose again. And yes, He stands in victory. Sin curses yours, His grip on me. For I am His, and He is mine. For in the precious blood of Christ, no guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life first cry to final breath, Jesus command my destiny. No power of God or sin or man can ever blot me from His hand. Till He returns or calls me home, here in the palm of Christ I stand. On Christ the holy rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. On Christ the holy rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. In terms of coming home, here in the palm of Christ I stand. Psalm chapter 32, verse 7. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble. You will surround us with song of deliverance. Let's sing this song meaningfully to God. Yes, Lord, we trust in you. Amen.
Let us together seek the face of the Lord as you come before His throne of grace and lift our prayers to Him. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, today is Labor's Day. We're reminded, O God, that work is something that you have created for mankind. And pray, Father, that you bless all the handwork of mankind. I mean, mankind do what is good, right, and proper as good stewards of the earth that God have made them stewards of. We bless you, Father. We praise and thank you that today is a day off for the labors. And Lord, just pray, even as people work, we're concerned about the migrant workers in the midst of us. As we hear news of how they've been mistreated, no proper accommodation, unfair salary, and some other problems. Father, we just pray, God, that all the employers, the companies, will truly treat migrant workers as people who deserve better. And even now, as the government talk about the minimum wage of 1.5K, right company, even if they think about their profit, they also think about their social responsibility to take care of their workers. And therefore, Lord, may you guide companies to do what is good, right, and proper in this matter. Father, as we come before you, we want to remember those who are unwell due to COVID-19. Lord, we do pray for Reverend Victor and his family, for Sarah's and their son, Santos, and for Brother Tony. We continue to pray, God, for your divine help, your divine intervention, to bless them with the healing that they need, O God. May they know your peace. May they know your presence. And Father, just trust in you that all of us who were present in church on last Sunday, who had interaction with Reverend Victor, that you continue to protect us from the virus. And also can you pray, O Lord, for all as we go out, beginning today, May the 1st, where SOPs are a bit more relaxed. Lord, we do pray that we will not be complacent. We will not put down our guards, but we continue to be alert and conscientious about our role, our responsibility to ensure that we will not transmit any disease and we will not contract any disease as well. Oh Lord, have mercy. Father, we do remember too, Sister Anna's daughter, Jennifer, in Adelaide. We ask that your grace of healing will also be upon her. We bless you, Father. We thank you. For those, Lord, who are unwell, going through treatment, needing, oh God, your touch, pray for your presence to be with them. Pray, oh God, for your healing grace to be sufficient for them. Pray for your peace, oh Lord, upon them. Lord, remember Sister Anna, remember Sister Janice Leong, remember Sister Peggy Wong, remember Brother Leonard Cheong. Lord, please draw near to them. Bless their treatment. Bless their bodies with your healing grace, oh God. We thank you, Father, we praise you. Lord, we thank you for the upcoming holidays in view of the Raya celebration. We pray for all who are traveling outstation, even as we hear about roads being so congested, towns being so congested. We pray a lot where there are jams, congestions. We pray for your peace, your presence. And we just pray, God, that you bless every family and meet together during this holiday season. Pray there shall be no clusters, there shall be no outbreaks, O Lord, of the COVID. Have mercy, dear Father. And as you think about the Raya celebration, it's open to pray for the peace, for the harmony, for the perpaduan and muhibah in our country, Malaysia. The people of all races can continue to live together as Malaysians, Lord, respecting each other's race and each other's religion. We bless you, Father. We thank you for the freedom of religion in our country, for we can still worship you so freely. We bless you, God. We thank you. Once again, Father, we just commit our online service to you today. For all who are present thus far, we thank you. Lord, we pray for those who are not able to log in today, perhaps because they do not have the technology. But just pray, God, for those who have the technology and are not logging in. You know who they are. You know where they are. Pray, Father, that you guide their hearts, their commitment towards you, and their commitment to towards your church, the Wesleyan Community Methodist Church. And Father, just pray, Lord, for this online service. Just pray that all things will go well. There'll be good connectivity for those who are watching, following online. And your presence will be with everyone as you celebrate even the Holy Communion today. Your presence to encourage, to build up. We bless you, Father. So, Lord, we just commit this whole morning service unto you. And we pray, Father, that your guidance be upon us through this day. We bless you, Father. We thank you. In Jesus' name, we pray. And together, let's say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is taken from Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 to 20. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
I love to tell the story of the things above, oh Jesus and his glory, oh Jesus and his glory. I love to tell the story because I know this truth. He said, what's in me, I tell thee, more wonderfully sweet.
Good morning, dearly beloved in the Lord. Yeah, as what Brother William mentioned, today we have to meet online because of what happened the last week. So may the Lord continue to be gracious to grant healing to those who are affected by the COVID-19. Now take a look at this beautiful cathedral, this beautiful church building. It belongs to the Presbyterian Church in Muswell Hill, North London. It was built in 1902, replacing an earlier building built in 1898 that became the church hall. The church was disused in 1973. After the creation of the United Reformed Church, although the hall was used until 1976, it became the O'Neill's pub. And now it has become the Miller and Carter Restaurant. An article by the Business Insider reads, and this is the context for UK. At one church, the only thing being worshipped is beer. At another, gleaming cars are on sale. Increasingly, it seems, a different kind of conversion is taking place at Britain's churches. Due to a steady decline in religion, and the high cost of maintaining these historic buildings, a rising number of churches are being given new lives that may have horrified their founders. The question is, what happened? The insider gave a clue. Religious worship has been declining in Britain for years. In January 2022, the Church Times published this news. Number of Christians in England and Wales falls to just over half of population, that is 51%. This is a fall of more than 8%. Since the 2011 census, the lowest yet recorded. As you see what is happening in England, this will surely cause alarm bells to ring for us, the Malaysian Christians. We are only about 10%. Here you see, we are just about 9.2. Yeah. So I'm not sure what's the latest statistics, 2020, yeah? But we say we have 10% of population with majority in Sabah and Sarawak. In Selangor, we are only about 3.8% of the population. So how is the church in Malaysia doing? Is it growing? Is it stagnant? Is it declining? Will there be church buildings that will be closed due to decline of religious worship, just as in England? I hope this will never happen. With this hope this morning, I want to share with us the topic, the disciples' mission. Let's pray before I proceed further. Lord, even as we come to this time to hear your word, I pray, God, for your anointing of the Spirit upon my mind, my lips, and my heart. I pray, God, that you bless my voice that is strong and proclaim your word. I pray, Father, that you bless the listeners, even as they listen in now. Grant, O Lord, faith, understanding. Thank you, Father, we praise you. So we commit this time for the ministry of your word into your loving care. Speak to us, O God, as how you want us to know your will, your plan and purposes for us individually and for us as a church. We bless you, Father. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When every disciple understands that he or she has a mission and he goes about fulfilling the mission, I believe the church will never close. So, what is the disciples' mission? It has to do with reaching out and bringing the lost into the church, into God's kingdom. Those in WCMC prayer chat group will receive from me this weekly prayer guide prepared by the 24/7 Prayer Asia. In this document, you will notice point number 5, entitled Reach the Lost. Then you'll notice it says pray for 5. It reads for 5 friends, family, and or colleagues to come to faith in Christ. Uphold them daily in prayer. Be intentional in making authentic friendship and pray faithfully for their salvation. Pray for entire families to become Christians or to come to Christ. Now, I remember when I was a student at Tar College, you know, long time ago, between 1976 to 79, I had housemates who were not Christians. And being the only Christian, it was really tough. I did not like to get into argument with them. During that time, the word of Romans chapter 10, verse 1 guided me. It says here, brothers, my heart's desire and prayer to God for them is that they may be saved. This was the Apostle Paul's desire for the salvation of his people, the Jews. I, however, took this and applied to my situation. So I wrote down the names of my housemates and placed this list on my door. Whenever I look at the list, I'm reminded to pray for them, for their salvation. Time went by and we went our own ways. I did not share the gospel with them, but at least I did my little part to pray for their salvation then. Fast forward to today. To pray for people's salvation is our little step to leading them to faith in Christ. So let's again look at the Great Commission text that was read this morning, found in Matthew 28, verses 18 to 20. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. For today, I just want to look at the phrase, go therefore and make disciples. Go therefore and make disciples. Now, this is the verse which many churches will kind of borrow, adopt, and come up with church visions such as a disciple making church. This is the very heart of the Great Commission. And so the argument is that Jesus did not say, go and make believers, or go and make converts, or go and make Christians. Jesus clearly said, go and make disciples. Because of the verb go and make, we will see that disciples do not miraculously appear. They are not readily found in within the believing church. If this were so, Jesus would not have asked his early disciples to go and make disciples. I think the idea is, if we want to fish, we do not fish in an aquarium. Instead, we need to go to the river, to the pond, to the sea. So the making of disciple is a very tedious and challenging process. You may have watched your favorite movie, Spider-Man: No Way Home. This is the finished product. To know the processes, how this movie was made, all the hard work put in, the sweat, the mistakes, the tension, and the struggles, you have to watch. It says here, behind the scene, the bloopers, the making of the movie. So today, I'm attempting to take us to the beginning of the process of the making of a disciple. In book 4 of the Master Life course, entitled The Disciple's Mission, it has a chapter entitled Master Builder, which contains a meaningful diagram that helps us see the whole discipling process. It gives us an insight into the stages of development in a disciple's life. Let me quote Avery Willis' brief explanation of these stages. First, people are spiritually dead. They are dead in their sins and do not know Christ. Spiritually dead persons cannot respond to Christ except as the Holy Spirit draws them. When the Spirit of God convicts persons and they repent, call on Jesus and are saved, they become, from spiritually dead, they become spiritual children. Spiritual children have many of the same traits as physical children. As they grow, they become spiritual disciples. As spiritual disciples mature, they become disciple makers, helping others in the same growth process. As disciple makers continue to develop, they finally become co-laborers in the ministry. And they continue to reach out to the lost and to make disciples. Now, this is the complete movie of disciple making. It begins with the condition of people without Christ. They are spiritually dead. They need to know that they are sinners and are in need of forgiveness. They need to know that God wants to give them abundant life and everlasting life. They need to hear the message of salvation, that God loves them and wants to forgive them of their sins and give them the right to become children of God. So the question is, who will be responsible for sharing this message with those who are spiritually dead? The answer would be, this is the job of the pastor. No, this is the job for all the disciple makers. So are you a disciple maker for Christ? In Romans 10:13, it says, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Saved simply means helping people move from spiritually dead to become spiritual children. That is, they become children of God. And verse 14 presents, Romans 10 verse 14 presents us with a question. How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? So how can we help the spiritually dead to become children of God? We need to give them an opportunity to hear the good news about Jesus so that they can call on Jesus and thus believe on Jesus. In order for this to happen, somebody must preach or share the good news with them. However, we struggle with this. And how are they to preach unless they are sent? So are you sent to share the good news of Jesus with those around you? Yes? No? Hear again what Jesus said. Go and make disciples. Has Jesus sent you and I? Do we hear the command? Go. People must be given the opportunity to hear about Jesus. At the end of it, it is their free choice to respond to or to reject the love of Jesus. Our mission is to go. This, therefore, is the disciples' mission. And the title of my sermon today, The Disciples' Mission. So are you beginning to get a feel of what is the disciples' mission? His mission is to become a disciple maker. Hear again what Jesus said to his disciples. Follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. Jesus wants his disciples to become fishers of men. Jesus wants his disciples to go, that is, to be involved in his mission and to share his message. Jesus said this about his mission. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. So we are to seek and to save the lost for Jesus. We have to do the fishing. Fish people for Jesus. And about fishing, I remember many years ago when I went to Sarawak to the longhouses for mission. Now, one evening, I was kind of watching the children fishing in the river. And I decided to join in the fun with them. They gave me a line and a hook and a bait. With amazement, I watched them pulling out their lines, the little black color ikan keli, hanging on the end of their line. I watched their joy when they saw the fish that they caught. With embarrassment, I waited for a fish to bite my bait. Finally, I landed a catch. Phew, what a joy it was. No, it was a tiny ikan keli, you know, but it was such a joy to catch one. So let me just share with you this morning my ikan keli stories, my small experiences about sharing the gospel Jesus said, "Follow me, I'll make you become fishers of men." So, WCMCPJ has been using the Alpha course. It was called later on, now it's called Alpha Church, you know. And they use this as a tool to reach out to win souls for Christ. And because of the way the Alpha program is designed, it requires a well-organized team and many hands to kind of help to run the program, the church. So it's a group effort. As for me, I was exposed to Alpha way back in 2004. But even before there was this Alpha course, there was what we call personal evangelism, where we use the four spiritual laws. Yeah. It was one-on-one sharing the gospel. I was exposed to this slogan, "Each one, win one," by my mother church, the Klang Chinese Methodist Church. Now, to achieve this, we were taught how to share the gospel using the four spiritual laws. I recall how we went from house to house, from Taman to Taman on Sunday evenings to share the gospel. The message drummed into our young minds was success in witnessing is simply sharing Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit and leaving the result to God. In the youth fellowship back in the 70s, we sang songs that reinforced the importance of soul winning. I will never forget this short but simple and powerful song. "Lord, lay some soul upon my heart and love that soul through me. And may I bravely do my part to win that soul for thee." There is a more stirring hymn, "Rescue the Perishing." As it says here, "Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them in pity from sin and the grave. Weep, O the erring one, lift up the fallen, tell them of Jesus, the mighty to save. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save." And the second stanza says, "Though they're slighting him, still he is waiting, waiting the penitent child to receive. Plead with them earnestly, plead with them gently. He will forgive if only they believe." Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. I may not forget, I may not remember the hymn totally, there are four stanzas, but the title of the hymn itself, "Rescue the Perishing," will be kind of playing in my mind. I gave my heart to Jesus at the age of 17 years old. And I was then given this vision of soul winning. Now, I didn't know much about discipleship. I only know that I have to share the gospel. And from every village description, I was doing the task of leading the spiritually dead to become spiritual children. Now, I'm not sure how many of you will remember this particular campaign run by Campus Crusade for Christ Malaysia and was kind of worldwide. The I Found It campaign in the 1970s. So this phrase was published in various places, in various ways, and those paper buttons, posters, banners, road signboards, and all that. So they put up in supermarkets, you know, those banners, the buntings, all that. So after a period of creating that kind of excitement, the follow-up with I Found It, you can find it too. And they give you a number to call. Now, that was a really special time in the history of evangelism. And I was kind of involved with this as well, listening to the phone calls, visiting the people who want to find out more. You know, and the movie Jesus was also screened in the cinemas and invite people to go and watch it. So I just say that evangelism and soul winning was sown in my heart from the early days of my Christian life. So we were called to be involved with the conversion growth of the church. But as I grew up, other things took priority. My studies, my career, my church involvement. Strangely, as you get more involved in the church, you forget about outside. By and by, I entered seminary to be trained to become a pastor. When I became the pastor or a pastor, the responsibility to win souls took on a different dimension. Pastors must win soul for the Lord. The church must grow. Souls must be added to the church. There must be conversion growth. But oh, soul winning is so difficult. Because as a pastor, I was associating more with my church members, with Christians. I remember when I was at the Chinese annual conference, it was a big challenge for us because our KPI was we must present a 10% growth in the church. We must report a 10% growth in the church. Wow, great pressure. Now, I have had the opportunities to share the gospel and lead people to faith in Christ over the years. However, I will never forget on my early experiences as a pastor reaching out. So there was this man who was in his 40s, who was celebrating his 40th birthday. His wife was concerned for his salvation. So somehow the Lord moved me to go and visit him. And I shared the gospel with him. And I had to just praise and thank God that this man, at the age of 40, he opened his heart and he received Jesus as his personal Lord and Savior. So slowly he came to church. And then as I look at him, I kind of ask him, Mr. Tan, do you have a driving license? Because he comes to church by motorbike. So I asked him, do you have a driver license? He said, yes, I have. So I said, would you mind helping to drive the church van? Because I was doing it at that time, driving the church van, you know, to pick children for Sunday school, to pick the youth for the youth fellowship. I was the van driver. So I said, yes, Pastor, I would like to volunteer. So with that, I handed him the key and he became the volunteer driver on Saturday and on Sunday. And he went on to be a faithful church member and church van driver. And many people were blessed through that ministry. When I was serving my home church in Klang, the Klang Chinese Methodist Church, around 2006, we began to be involved in the migrant ministry. It's called the Migrant Ministry Klang. You know, we're reaching out to the Myanmarese, to the Vietnamese, to the Nepali, to the Telugu-speaking people. Few churches in Klang came together. So my church, the Klang Chinese Methodist Church, we host the Vietnamese ministry. And in the years I was involved with this ministry till I moved on, it was a joy to lead many Vietnamese to faith in Christ. It was a joy to see many of them getting baptized. So when the time came, I changed conference. So I have to leave my Klang Chinese Methodist Church and I joined Track in 2010 and I was posted to JB Wesley. So I will never forget the ikan kelis that I was able to catch when I was in JB Wesleyan. So when I was first there, I visited a family. There were three elderly ladies there, three sisters. And I get to know them. I shared the gospel with them. And I praise God, all three of them in their 80s and early 90s, they received Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. So it was all God's timing. And JB Wesley too had Alpha. So working along with Alpha and doing one-on-one evangelism together, we reach out to win souls for Christ. So before I left JB Wesley, in 2016 I finished, and 2017 I came over to WCMCPJ. In 2016, December 26, I went to visit a family, and I just thank God that the man in his 80s and his daughter in the 40s, as I shared the gospel with them, they opened their hearts and they received Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And I immediately baptized them also before I left for JB to Trinity. So as I came over to TMCPJ, I attended my covenant service 31st December 2016. My first watch night service at TMCPJ. So I remember when we finished, the service was already the 1st of January 2017. And a member approached me and said, "Pastor, can you speak Mandarin?" I said, "Yeah, simple one, can lah." So I said, "Can you share the gospel with my mom, who's in her 80s? So I said, "Okay, I'll try." So I approach Madam Liu, and I get to small talk with her first, and then I shared the gospel with her. And I thank God, on the 1st of January 2017, Madam Liu opened her heart, and she received Jesus as her personal Lord and Savior. And I remember, on one of my pastoral visits to a home, the man, he had a heart issue, so has been absent from church. So I visited the family and got to know his wife. So as we talk, I realized that his wife is not a Christian. And again, she is Chinese speaking. So I shared the gospel with her. And I thank God that she was responsive. And she too received Jesus as her personal Lord and Savior. So these two ladies, Chinese speaking ladies, they believe, they were baptized, and they joined the Chinese congregation of TMCPJ. My prayer to God, my prayer to God is that I would be able to at least bring one soul a year to the Lord, just one soul a year to the Lord. And I want to thank God, since, coming over to TMCPJ, apart from these two senior ladies that I mentioned, I also given opportunity to share the gospel with other men. I want to recall three other men that I shared the gospel with. They received Christ. They are baptized. However, all these three men, they have now gone home to be with the Lord. One of them in 2019, another in 2021, and the latest, 8 February 2022. In 2017, I was introduced to a couple who attended the Methodist Senior Fellowship, Mr. and Mrs. Sito. So they were attending the fellowship. Mr. Sito was a school teacher, and he was not a Christian yet, but interestingly, he was teaching Bible knowledge. So I began to engage him in conversation. As I continue to engage with him, thank God that both Mr. and Mrs. Sito, they opened their hearts and they received Jesus as their Lord and Savior, and they baptized and became members of TMCPJ. However, I must confess that since 2020, I've not been able to win one soul for the Lord. Lord, have mercy. And I'm continually reminded of this scene. Lord, lay some soul upon my heart and win that soul for thee. So the Alpha online, the 24/7 prayer, keep reminding me of my disciple mission, of soul winning. Today, I have a list of names that I'm praying for. And I'm praying, God, open the door, open the opportunity for me to win one soul for you this year. One soul. Reaching out to win souls for Christ is not an easy thing. I just want to pray that God will keep the fire to win a soul for him, keep the fire burning in my heart. I want to thank the Lord to the past years for the little ikan kelis that I've been able to, you know, privileged to bring to the Lord. Remember, we, the disciples of Jesus, are called to be fishers of men. The whole process starts with sharing the gospel, the good news, with those who are spiritually dead and praying that the Holy Spirit will touch them and will cause them to respond to the love of God and to become spiritual children, the children of God. To win one soul for the Lord is such a difficult thing. And that's why the Bible says this. There is joy in the presence of God's angels when even one sinner repents. That is how precious one soul is in the presence of God. Another hymn that was drummed into me in my youth days with regard to soul winning is this hymn, Must I Go and Empty-Handed? Must I go and empty-handed, thus my dear Redeemer meet? Not one day of service give him, lay no trophy at his feet. Must I go and empty-handed? Must I meet my Savior's soul? Not one soul with which to greet him. Must I go and empty-handed? Think about it. Not one soul with which to greet him. Must I empty-handed go? Earlier, I mentioned about the church Alpha. Now, let me just share one of the video clips about Alpha to give us an insight about what church Alpha can do. Okay, let me just share the video.
The church is actually looking for some piece that would help us reach out to those who weren't coming in.
We really didn't know what we were doing. I mean, we knew a little bit what we were supposed to do. I think we were mostly surprised that people actually came.
We had 13 congregations that we were able to bring together. I saw this as a Philadelphia opera ministry.
It stays on the basics so that interdenominationally everybody can feel comfortable.
We're decent at some other things, but not decent at reaching out.
It creates a space for people to come and explore faith.
So we plunged into it, we just did everything we had.
Alpha's an opportunity to explore the meaning of life. And it's designed primarily for people who don't go to church, people who wouldn't call themselves Christians. And it's an opportunity to discuss the really big questions like, why am I here? What's the purpose of life? Does life have an ultimate meaning? And discuss these really big questions in a way that's very low-key, unpressurized, non-confrontational, based on respect for people, regardless of what they believe or what they think.
It's a place where you can come and connect and see, taste and see, you know?
It really is permission giving. So folks can come and they can sort of explore and ask the questions that they need to ask regarding the meaning of life, spirituality, you know, what am I here to do? What am I here for?
I think that's what's so precious about Alpha. It's like a cup of coffee in a coffee shop. It's real sweet.
When the church embraces the DNA of Alpha, which is a lot more than just doing the course, it's about a new way of doing church. It's about having a passion in your heart such that 24/7 you're thinking about, who can I make friends with? Who can I go and do life with and bless?
That first Alpha course, I personally called like 200 people and invited them. I don't think any of them showed up.
Our first Alpha course, we had 621 persons attending.
But we had these other people from the church who really loved people who didn't know Jesus, and they brought their friends. We had 40 people on our first Alpha course.
We started actually in a brewery. So the idea of coming and talking about whatever that we talked about and then moving the conversation to faith, as long as it was genuine, it felt pretty natural.
When the culture of the church is to go, which is, of course, the Great Commission, to go, as they go out to other people and make friends with them and then say, hey, would you like to come and hear some teachings about Jesus Christ? And let's have a chat about it. Then you start seeing real transformation. And we've heard of so many churches that were in decline, struggling, finances are going down, having to close off programs, things like that. And then they start looking out and using this tool called Alpha, which is all about introducing people to Jesus Christ. Now it goes the other way. They start to expand and grow.
60,000 churches are running it in every kind of cultural situation. It's running on campuses, it's running in the workplace, it's running in residential homes.
2 to 4 people are being settled in their faith, understanding the fundamentals of the gospel.
This is about Jesus getting onto the streets in people's lives right where they are.
And God uses it, I think, in ways that we don't really plan at the beginning.
The one thing that unites all those different places is the stories of the people whose lives have been transformed by Jesus Christ.
Something was missing in my life and I didn't know what it was. And while I was on the Alpha course, I just came to this epiphany that I wasn't alone out there.
Just being in a room with a group of people who are basically looking for the same thing more out of life.
The Alpha course actually taught me that life wasn't meant to be lived alone and that community was very important. And Jesus actually, through his love, was able to change my life by telling me, you are much more than just a work person. You are someone that I created. You are someone wonderfully made. You are someone that I love. And that, to me now, is what I want to live for.
The difference that Christ has made in my life was absolutely another step in life-changing moments.
Right, so I hope the video was helpful to give us an insight about what Alpha can do for us individually and what Alpha can do for the church corporately. That's something for us at WCMC to think about, okay? So are we ready to go about our mission as Christ disciples? So this then is the disciples' mission. To go and make disciples, be fishers of men. And let us begin by praying for the salvation of our loved ones, neighbors, and friends. When the opportunity presents itself before us, let us pray that we can share the gospel with them so that they can have an opportunity to respond to God's love. So about sharing the gospel, we can do it one-on-one, learning a tool like four spiritual laws or EE. And then we can also invite people to join the Alpha online. So at WCMC, I kind of, because WCMCPJ has this alpha online, now we have encouraged, I've encouraged Mr. Yuen Hon Kiong to join in. And so I encourage our brother Chan Wai Chung to join in so that his wife Melissa hopefully could join in. So this is challenging because to find time to join this online alpha is a big challenge. What I say is that when disciples of Jesus are faithful to carry out a mission, the church will grow stronger. The church will never close down. Okay? So let us arise. Let's go about our mission. God wants us to be disciple makers. God wants us to be fishers of men. God bless us. Amen. Let's pray. Gracious God, our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love for us. You have moved us to respond to your love. You have, O God, changed our lives. You have given us hope. Help us, O God. There are people who are still finding this whole question, the meaning and purpose of life, a big challenge. The whole issue of salvation is still a challenge. So we pray, Father, that you will make us, O Lord, your disciple makers, who will go out and help those who are spiritually dead to become spiritual children of yours. Grant us, O God, love and compassion for the lost. Give us names to pray for and give us opportunity to share your gospel. And we pray, O God, that our church, the Wesleyan Community Methodist Church, will be, O God, a church that will reach out and win souls for your kingdom. We bless you, Father. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, this we end the sermon. And now we come to this moment of the celebration of the Holy Communion. So I will read, and Brother William will represent the congregation to respond. Christ the Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let's take some moments to kind of search our hearts first and ask God to forgive us. Together, merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God.
To God. Amen. Amen. Next slide. The great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so, we are people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn together, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of faith together, saying, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here in our respective homes and on the gifts of bread and wine. May them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world. Until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
So now, with the confidence of children of God, together let's pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, wherever you are gathered, the body of Christ given for you.
Amen.
The blood of Christ given for you.
Amen.
So in your own homes, whatever the elements they're prepared, together in faith, let's partake of the Lord's communion. Let us pray. Gracious God, our loving Heavenly Father, for this moment, you can partake of the Holy Communion, an act by which the Lord said, as often as you do it in remembrance of me. So as we perform this act, we are remembering our Lord Jesus Christ, who loved us, who died for us on the cross, whose blood was shed for the forgiveness of our sins. And through Christ, we become children of God with the hope of eternal life, with the hope of heaven. For all the blessings given to us through your Son, Jesus, we give you thanks, O God, our Father. And as you remember Jesus, who loved us, help us, O God, to love you with all our heart, our soul, our mind, and our strength. Even as we feed on this communion, we ask, O God, that the benefits of the communion be experienced by us, the forgiveness of sins, as well as the healing that comes. For Lord, your words say, by your stripes we are healed. So we thank you, O God, for the possibility of healing through the communion. We bless you, Father. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, over to you, Pauline.
Yeah.
Father, we thank you for this time to worship you. We have come to worship when we ask of you, Lord, as you depart, send us out into the world to serve you, to be your ambassador, to be the light of the world, to be the salt of the earth. O God, our Father, as we enter this new month, the month of May, with all the knowns and the unknowns, with all the challenges before us, we continue to ask of you that you help us to walk close to you, to lean upon you, to trust in you. As the word tells us, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not upon your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he will make straight your path. So help us, O God, to walk with you, to look to you for your counsel in all that we plan to do through this month. We bless you, God, Father. We praise and thank you. Again, Lord, we do ask for your mercy and grace of healing for our sicknesses. Especially, we ask, Lord, for your protection from COVID-19. We ask God for the building up of our body immunity system to fight and to overcome the virus. We thank you, Father. We praise you. Watch our nation, Malaysia, O God, as we enter into the next phase of endemicity with the relaxation of SOPs, O Father. Watch over Malaysia, please. We bless you, Father. We thank you. And now, my brothers and sisters, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace. And may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus now and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor.